Hello everyone, hi. Just waiting for the video to go live on YouTube. Just checking in if any of you can see me already. Please write a hi or a hello or an okay if you can see me live on the channel already. Okay, I can see myself. Hi everyone, hello and welcome to another doubt class. Now, in these classes, as you might know, we discuss doubts that have been sent by students. If you want your doubts to be discussed for future reference, I'll take one doubt class every Wednesday. Every weekend. And if you want your doubts to be discussed in that, please email me on my mail ID, which is ravihanda@gmail.com, so that I can pick up your doubts. Now, for those of you who might be attending my classes for the first time, my name is Ravi Handa. I have been teaching for CAT for close to 15 years now, and I've taught 20,000 plus students online via my own website. Recently, I started taking classes on Unacademy. Well, as a part of Unacademy, I'm taking a bunch of classes, let's say on YouTube, the special classes and the paid courses, which are known as plus courses on Unacademy. Now, as a part of the special classes, I'm conducting a business awareness quiz at 7 p.m. tomorrow. At 7 p.m. tomorrow, so you please take part in that. If you want the link for that or any other similar updates, I'll recommend that you join our Telegram group at CAT Prep Online. In the month of June and July, I will be conducting a paid course on Unacademy in which I will cover the complete logical reasoning. I'll start from the basics and then go till the end. Then some of the classes, the difference between the plus courses and these regular free classes is that you get the classes in a structured format. That is, you do this, then you do this, and so on. In the iconic plan, you get personalized guidance as well. Now, let's start off with the first question. So it's a long question. It's a long question with a long list. But before I actually go to the questions, please read the text and let me know when you want me to scroll to the next slide. Hi Jaydev. Hi Vikas. Good to see you guys here. In the table below, the listing of players is given, seeding from the highest to the lowest. So 1 to 32 rankings are given, who are due to play in the Association of Tennis Players Tournament for Women. So these are my rankings 1 to 32. Then this tournament has 4 knockout rounds before the finals, first, second, quarter and semis. In the first round, the highest seeded player plays the lowest seed player, which is number 32, which is designated as match 1. Then the second seed player plays the 31st seeded player, which is designated as match 2, and so on. Thus, for instance, match number 16 of the first round will be played between the 16th and the 17th seeded player. In the second round, winner of match number 1 and winner of match number 16 are play the designated match number 1 of the second round. Basically, what is happening is, in round 1, 1 will play against 32, 2 will play against 31, 3 will play against 30, and this list will go on till 16 playing against 17. So this is round 1. Now, since it's a knockout tournament, 16 of these players will win and 16 of these players will lose. I'm assuming that the better ranked player won. If the better ranked player won, now I will have players from 1 to 16 in round 2. So 1 will play with 16, 2 will play with 15, and this will go on till 7 will play 17. So 7 will play with 9. Sorry, 7 will play with 10, 8 will play with 9. So these are the 8 matches in round 2. Then we have quarterfinals. 8 players, let's say the 1 to 8 qualify. So 1 versus 8, 2 versus 7, 3 verses 6 and 4 verses 5. Then we'll have the semifinals. Semifinals will be 1 verses 4, 2 verses 3. And then we'll have the final as 1 verses 2. Now, in this, I've obviously made an assumption. And what is my assumption? My assumption is that the higher ranked player or the better ranked player is always winning. Similarly, the winner of match number 2 will play the winner of match number 15, which is essentially what is described here. So are you guys okay with this sort of a description as to these are the matches which will take place? Are you guys okay with these are the matches being taken place in round 1 to the final? Jaydev is okay. What about you, Himanshu and Vikas? Are you guys okay with these matches? Okay. Now, these are the rankings of the player. Obviously, you'll need to see. I'll go a little bit fast in this because, you know, it's not something that you're solving in the exam. I'll still try to explain. So if there are no upsets, that means a lower seeded player beating a higher seeded player in the first round, and only matches 6, 7 and 8 of the second round result in an upset. Okay. So this is perfect. This is perfect. 1 to 16 have won as was expected. But in the second round, 6, 7 and 8 are upsets. So if in the second round 6, 7 and 8 are upsets, that means 6 versus 11. These matches resulted in upsets. So 9-1, 10-1 and 11-1. On this side, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 won. So if 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 won and 9, 10 and 11 won here, then the match between will not be 1 and 8, it will be 1 and 9. 2 and 10, 3 and 11, 4 and 5 match will continue as if. 4 and 5 match will continue as if. Then who will meet Lindsay Davenport in the quarterfinal? So Lindsay Davenport is ranked, where is Lindsay Davenport? 2. So who is meeting 2 in the quarterfinals? 2 is meeting ranked 10 in the quarterfinals. 2 is meeting rank 10 in the quarterfinals and rank 10 is Venus Williams. Which means the answer for this particular question is Venus Williams. Are you guys okay with Venus Williams as the answer? Because 2 played against rank 10. If you guys are okay with this, then I'll go to the next question. Sajan Jaydev had sent this as a doubt. Jaydev, are you okay with this? 2 versus 10 or Venus Williams as the answer? Vikas is also fine. Jaydev is also fine. I will go ahead. Let me just rub this off. See, why am I rubbing this off? For the reason that my table looks a little bit cleaner. What I've done is, first question answer is 4 because 2 will play against rank. Let's look at the next one. If Elena Dimitrieva and Serena Williams lose in their second round, so Elena and Serena are which rank? Elena is 6 and Serena is 8. So 6 and 8 lose. Okay. And Justin and Nadia make it to the semi-finals. So Justin and Nadia are 7 and 9. 7 and 9, I want to go to the semi-finals. Fine. I'll keep that in mind. So 6 and 8 have lost and 7 and 9 have moved ahead. So 6 versus 11, 6 lost, 11 moved ahead, 7 won, 10 lost, 9 won, 8 lost. So 7 and 9 have won, 6 and 8 have lost. So instead of 6, 7 and 8, I'll have 11, 7 and 9. So 7 will remain. Instead of 8, I will have 9. Instead of 7, 7 will remain. Instead of 6, I will have 11. Now, I'm also given another fact that Justin and Nadia, which were ranked 7 and 9, they made it to the semi-finals. So, 7 and 9 made it to the semi-finals. So, 7 and 9 are moving ahead. So, 7 will come in place of 2. This will be 7. 9 will come in place of 1. So, this will be 9. So, these are my semi-finals. Now, I look at the question. What does the question say? Question says, who would play Maria Sharapova in the quarters if Sharapova reaches the quarters? So, Sharapova is rank 1. Who is playing rank 1 in quarters? In quarterfinals, rank 1 is being played by rank 9. Who is rank 9? 9 is Nadia Petrova. Seven is upset. No. It says 7, Justin Henin made it to the semi-finals. Justin Henin made it to the semi-finals. So 7 is not an upset. Is that what you are saying, Sajan? So Maria Sharapova, 1 will play rank 9 and rank 9 is Nadia Petrova. Are you guys okay with this? Nadia Petrova is the answer for the second question because 1 will play 9. 1 will play 9 in the quarterfinals. Sajan is fine. What about you, Jaydev, Vikas? Are you okay with this? Okay, I'll once again rub this off and go back to the original. So, this came out as 3 because in quarterfinal, 1 will play against 9. 1 will play against 9. Next one. If the top 8 seeds make it to the quarterfinals. So, my quarterfinals are 1 versus 8, 2 versus 7, 3 versus 5, sorry, 3 versus 6 and 4 versus 5. These are my quarterfinals. Then, who would definitely not play against Maria Sharapova? Now we want him to definitely not play against Maria Sharapova in the final. So first of all, in the finals, Maria Sharapova is reaching. So she must have beaten rank 8. In the semifinals, who must be against 1? It will be either 4 or 5. Whoever it was, she would have beaten them. What about the other match? Now, the other match, there are various possibilities. For the other match, it is possible that 2 and 3 won. So, it could be 2-3. Or it could be 2 and 6. Because 2-1 here and 6-1 here. Or it could be 7 and 3. Or it could be 7 and 6. Which means the final could be against 2 or 3 or 6 or 7. All these four opponents are possible. Then will definitely not play. So we need to find out their ranks. Emily is rank 3. Okay. Elena, where is Elena? Is rank 6. Kim Clijsters is rank 4. So, this is rank 4. And Lindsay Davenport is rank 7. Lindsay Davenport is rank 2. So she can play against 3, she can play against 6, she can play against 2. 2, 3 and 6 are possible. 4th rank, which is Kim Clijsters, that is not possible. Even if she plays Kim, she would have played Kim in the semi-finals and she would have beaten over there. So that's why my answer here would be Kim Clijsters. So Vikas got this correct. Vikas got this correct as Kim Clijsters. Jaydev and everyone else, are you guys okay with this? Then, in the first round, all even numbered matches and none of the odd numbered ones result in upsets. Okay. So basically, one, then 2 versus 31 was there. So 31, so this is my round 1. So 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, 15. And then I have the odd numbered matches, which is, so 16 versus 17 would have been there. So 17, 1 here, 19, 1 here, 21, 1 here, 23, 1 here, 25, 1 here, 27, 1 here, 29, 1 here, and 31, 1 here. Are you guys okay with the results of the first 16 matches of round 1? 1, 3, 5, 7. So basically, all odd numbers have won. Basically, all odd numbers have won. There are no upsets in the second round. There are no upsets in the second round. So what will be my matches in the second round? My matches in the second round will be 1 versus the last one, which is 17. Then 31 against 15. Then 3. So basically there will be 1, 3, 5 and 7. Whoever they play against, 1, 3, 5, 7 will win. Whoever they play against, 1, 3, 5, 7 will win. And From the other side, 9, 11, 13 and 15 will win. So that will be 9, 11, 13 and 15 will win. These are the winners. Are you guys okay with these? Okay, so this is, or let me just write it as, you know, to bring in a little bit more clarity. 1, 3, this is 15. Now, if you actually want to list down the losers, I will list down the losers here as well. So 17, 3 versus 19, 5 versus 21, 7 versus 23, then 9 versus 25, 11 versus 27, 13 versus 29 and 15 versus 31. So these are my round 2 matches which has no upsets. What will happen in round 3? In round 3, first match against last match, so 1 versus 9. Then it will be 3 versus 7. Sorry, second match. So 15 versus 7. Then 3 versus 11 and 5 versus 13. This will be my round 3, which is also known as the quarterfinals. So this much I know for sure. In round 1, all even were upsets. Round 2, no upsets. Round 3 or quarterfinals, this is my ranking. Let's check now. Then who could be the lowest seeded player facing Maria Sharapova in the semi-finals? Now, in the semi-finals against Maria Sharapova, that is against rank 1, who will play? The winner of this match, either 5 or 13, both of these are possible. Who is rank 5 and who is rank 13? So, Svetlana could be there. Or Anastasia could be there. So this one could be Svetlana, which is rank 5, or Anastasia, which could be 13. What is the question asking? These cannot be there. It could be either 5 or 13. The lowest seeded player possible. So the lowest seeded player among 5 and 13 is indeed 13, which is Anastasia. Are you guys okay with this? Yes, because 13, Anastasia could be the lowest seeded player. Okay. Are you guys okay? Jaydev, are you okay with round 1, round 2, round 3, semi-finals? Which round do you have a problem with? Which round do you have a problem with? 5. So, in round 3, see, look at the matches here. First, against last. So, that's why I got 1 and 9. Then, second and second last. That's how I got 15 and 7. Then, third and third last. So, that's how I got 3 and 11. And then, 5 and 13. This was the fourth match versus the fifth match. Now, 5 and 13 are the lowest seeded players, which are possible to go against 1 and 9, We are given that Maria Sharapova reaches the finals. We are given the Maria Sharapova reaches the semifinals. So she will play against 5 or she will play against 13. 5 is lowest. No, 13 is lowest. Have they defined low as something else? The highest seeded player plays against the lowest seeded player. So 32 is the lowest seeded player. 32 is the lowest seeded player. 5 is the lowest seed. There is a difference between ranking and seeding. There's a ranking and seeding are different. So 1 is the top seed player. 32 is the lowest seeded player. That is given to us in the question. 1 and 32. 1 is the highest and 32 is the lowest. So if 1 is the highest, 32 is the lowest. Among 5 and 13. Among 5 and 13, which one is lower? Among 5 and 13, 13 is lower. No. When we are defining seeds, we have already said that 32 is the lowest. Think of it as ranks. Think of it as ranks, Jaydev. I hope that would clarify. Think of it as rank. Rank 1 is better or rank 3 is better? Rank 1 is better, right? Rank 3 is a lower rank than rank 1. As a number, it might be bigger. Okay, let me remind you that there are a bunch of batches which are starting. There is a batch starting on the 29th of May. That's tomorrow. On 2nd of June, on 5th of June, you can go ahead and join any of these batches. If you are planning to enroll, I'll recommend that you go in for the 6-month plan. And you can use the coupon code HANDA in that. That will get you an additional 10% off. If you register today, you'll get the course valid till CAT 2021. Basically, you'll get an extension for free. And tomorrow, there is a scholarship test that is going to be conducted. You can take that on the Unacademy app. To unlock that, you can use the coupon code HANDA, which will give you a 1-year subscription for free if you perform well. Let's try the next question, which was sent by Shriya Jain. This is something you should be able to do in your head without pen and paper. What do you guys think will be the answer for this one? From 4, 5, 8 and 11, it leaves the remainder of 2, but when divided by 12, it leaves no remainder. That means the number is divisible by 12. If a number is divisible by 12, that means that number automatically is divisible by 4 also. If a number is divisible by 12, it is divisible by 12 and all its factors. Which means there is no such number which will satisfy these criteria. Because if it is divisible by 12, it will automatically be divisible by 4. You cannot get a remainder of 2 when you divide by 4. I don't think Shriya is there in class, but I hope she watches the recording and understands. I think there is some mistake in this question, or maybe it is given just to confuse the students. How about this one? Log x to the base 2 plus log x to the base 4 is equal to log of root 6 to the base 0.25. How about this one? This was sent by Angshuk. So log x to the base 2 is basically log x by log 2. Log x to the base 4 is log x by log 4, which is 2 log 2. And this is equal to log of root 6, which is 6 to the power half. And log of 0.25, which is log of 1 by 4. Now log of 6 to the power half is half log 6. Log of 1 by 4 is minus of log 4, or minus 2 log 2. So what is my overall equation? Log x by 2 plus log x by 2 log 2. My left hand side becomes 3 by 2 into log x by log 2. What about my right hand side? My right hand side will be minus 1 by 4. Minus 1 by 4 into log 6 by log 2. Log 2, log 2 cancels. 2 and 4 gets cancelled. I am left with a 2, which means log x is minus 1 by 6 log 6, which is log 6 to the power of minus 1 by 6, which gives me the value of x as 6 to the power of minus 1 by 6 given to me as option. Option 4, Satyam, not sure how you got that. Oh, it's Shriyak. Made a mistake there. Angshuk, it's okay. 6 to the power of minus 1 by 6. Good to see that, Angshuk. This was sent by Kash Maulik. Please try this out. Sum of the digits of the largest prime factor of n. When we are given n as 9 square plus 72 square. If you think about it, is 3 to the power 4 into 2 cube, plus 2 cube into 3 square to the power 2 whole square, which is 3 to the power 4 plus 2 to the power 6 into 3 to the power 4. Should be very clear and should be able to quickly solve it now. So for n, I can take 3 to the power 4 common. I'll be left with 1 plus 2 to the power 6, which is 3 to the power 4 into 65, 1 plus 64, which is 3 to the power 4 into 5 into 13. So the largest prime number is 13. Sum of the digits of 13 is 1 plus 3 or 4. Are you guys okay with this? Sum of the digits as 4. All I have done is I have just taken the values of n and sorted it out. I have just taken n, I have taken 3 to the power 4 common from it, and which has led me to the answer. Another question which was sent by Kash Maulik. Please try this out. Should be easy. This one is also on the simpler side. Should be easy. What do you guys think is the answer here? Pen was sold at a 15% loss. Had it been sold for 2.4 more, then it would have been a profit instead of a loss. The magnitude being equal in each case. The magnitude being equal in each case. So how do I get the value here? Suppose this is the price of the object. It was sold at 15% loss. Now I'm given that if I add 2.4 to it, then the amount of profit and the amount of loss will be equal. The amount of profit and the amount of loss will be equal, which means that this 15% of P is half of 2.4. 15% of P is half of 2.4. So P is 2.4 divided by 0.15 into 2 or 2.4 divided by 0.3, which is 8 rupees. Sajan, I think you made a calculation mistake somewhere. Please understand the fundamental idea that whatever is your loss, the same amount you are having in profit if you add 2.4. So if you add 2.4, that means that the negative part and the positive part are the same. That means to get back to the original, how much do you need? You need half of this, or you need 1.2 rupees as the addition. So your loss was 15% of P, which is 2.4 by 2, and then I got the value of P as 8 rupees. Straightforward question. Please try this one out. So try and make this arrangement. I'll go and get some water in the meanwhile. Try and make this arrangement. You have to form three groups. Satyam, Shivam and Sundaram. There are 10 people, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, N, J. They go for a camp. Three groups are formed, Satyam, Shivam and Sundaram, such that there were at least three students in a group. So 10 groups are there. So the group sizes are going to be 3, 3, 4. Then B, F, H and I are girls. So let me indicate the girls as B, H, I, H and F. These are my girls. Each group contained at least one girl. There are four girls, so the number of girls has to be 112. Is it necessary that these two girls are in this group? No. It is also possible that out of these three, that there are two girls here, and out of these four, there is one girl here. That is also very much possible. I need two students who can cook and two students who can put up a tent. Then, F is the only girl in the Satyam group. So let me make these groups now. Satyam group, there is only one girl who is F. The other two have to be males. What else do I know? Let me also note down the cooks and tents. A, C, E, F, J, H. So, I have my cooks as A, C, E, F, J, H. Or let me note it down in a slightly different way. So I have A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. These are the 10 people that I have. Out of them, A, C, E, F, J, H can cook. So, A, C, E, F, J and H can cook. These are my cooks. And B, C, D, G, H, I can put up a tent. So, B, D, G and I can put up a tent. Who are the ones who are repeating? C and H are the ones who can do both. So, C can do both. H can do both. So these are my special people. And who are the females? B, F, H, I are females. So, B is a female, F is a female, H is a female, and I is a female. Are you guys okay with this arrangement? I've written down what each one of them can do. So, which means Satyam has already got one cook. Now, what do I need? I need at least two tents. So, the other two must be able to put up a tent. The other two must be able to put up a tent because F cannot. Also, one of them should be a cook so that I can get two cooks. Now, cook and tent and it cannot be a female. That means this part has to be occupied by C. Are you guys okay with Satyam having F and C? So, this is gone. This is gone for Satyam. There is one position left which can be the tenth person, and this tenth person has to be a male. So, tenth person has to be a male. It can be D or G. So, for Satyam, it can be D or G. Are you guys okay with this? For Satyam, it being D or G as the tenth person. Cook and tent both was C, who is male. The only tent person could be D or G. Next condition, A and E were in the Sundaram group. So, Sundaram group has A and E. A and E are both males and A and E are both cooks. A is a cook, E is a cook. A and E are both cooks, so that means I definitely need two more tents. And not only I need two more tents, at least one of them should be a female. Both can be female. I am okay with that. But at least one of them has to be a female. Which one is that female? I don't know. Whether both are females, once again, I don't know. That is possible. But one of them has to be a female because A and E are males. So now I'm left with Shivam. Now, two cooks here, F and C are taken. A and E are taken as the two cooks here. I need two more cooks. There were a total of six cooks. So I need two cooks for Shivam. A is gone. Now I need two cooks. The only possible two cooks are H and J. only possible two cooks are H, female, and J. And J is only a cook, whereas H was also a cook and a tent. Now I have a cook and a tent, and now I need one more tent. Now I need one more tent. Could be a male or a female, I don't know. So I have taken H and J also. So now what is left? I have four positions left for the four tents. I have four positions left for the four tents. What are those four people? Those four people are B, D, G, and I, out of which B and I are females and D and G are males. One of the two males will come here. The other three positions could be out of these three, two positions are female. Out of these three, two positions are females. Which ones? I don't know. Are you guys okay with this as an arrangement? Jaydev, Sajan, Vikas, are you okay with the arrangement that I have made? Let's check the questions now. Which group has four students in it? Clearly, the only group that can have four students in it is Sundaram. So, Sundaram, which of the following students is definitely in the Shivam group? In the Shivam group, H and J are guaranteed. We have only J in the option, so this is J. If J and B are not in the same group, now, if J and B are not in the same group, that means B is not here. That means B has to be here. That means B has to be here. Then, which of the following students is definitely in the Sundaram group? Which of the following students is definitely in the Sundaram group? A, E, B have to be in the Sundaram group. A, E, B. We cannot say about G, J, I. G, J, I. J is definitely not there. G can be here. I can be here. We cannot say for sure about any of them. So, this one is cannot be determined. Move this B. Even if B goes there, we cannot be sure of, we know that J will not be there, but G and I, both of them can be going there. This is T. If there are two girls in the Sundaram group, okay, so let me use a different color for this. Two girls in the Sundaram group. In the Sundaram group, there are two girls. So I will put B and I as the two girls in the Sundaram group. So this position is D or G. This position is D or G. Then, which of the following students can be in the Shivam group? So Shivam group will have what? H, J, and DG. H and J have to be there. The third one could be D or G. So HJ is not here, HJ is not here, HJ is not here, HJG. This has to be my answer here. Finally, which of the following two students were not in the same group? B and D. B and D. I don't know, it is possible that B and D can come here. It is possible that B and D can come here. H and G. H and G. So H and G, we just saw that is also possible. That is also possible. F and D. F and D, the first group, that is also possible. C and I. C and I is not possible because the last position here has to be occupied by D or G. The last position here has to be occupied by D or G. So C and I can never be in the same group. Everything else is possible. Are you guys okay with this? Vikas, Jaydev. Jaydev had sent this as a doubt. Jaydev had sent this as a doubt. Are you guys okay with this? Okay. Let's check the next question. You have to find out the value of STR. STR. How do I calculate that? Should be simple enough. Should be simple enough. Look at the triangles that are complete wherever you know two angles. If you know two angles, the third one can be easily found out. If you know two angles, the third one can be easily found out. Use that idea to figure out the other angles. Use that idea to figure out the other angle. I'm asking you for this angle. This is my question. Can you tell me how much will be this angle? The angle that I've drawn here, what will be this value? Anyone? 100? Why? 50 and 30, total is 180. So this will be 100. So how much will be this angle? If this is 100, this is a straight line, this angle will be 80. Now, look at the arc QR. The arc QR, how much is it subtending on the circumference? 50 degrees? How much is it subtending on the circumference? 50 degrees. So this angle will be equal to this angle because they are both subtended. That will also be 50 degrees. What is left? This angle is left, which is what we are asked to find out. 180 minus 80 minus 50, which comes out as 50 degrees or option 3. Straightforward question. This was sent to us by Srihari. Hope you guys are okay with this. Then, probably, you know, the most complicated question, but if you use a little bit of logic, a little bit of Pythagoras, this should, you know, you should get to the answer very quickly. If you use Pythagoras, you know, intelligently, need to know where to apply that. So, how do I calculate this? How do I find this out? How do I get to the value? That's what the game is. Tell me, how do you get to the answers here? Two sides of a triangle are in the ratio of 3 to 4. Let's say these are my... So, this is 3x. This is 4x. Then, the medians to these sides are perpendicular to each other. So, let me draw the medians. So these are medians and we are given that these are perpendicular to each other. Now, the centroid divides the median in the ratio of 1 is to 2. So, if this is A, this is 2A. If this is B, this is 2B. Now, my question to you is, which will lead you to the answer. What is a square plus 2b square? And what is 2a square plus b square? If you can tell me these values, your question will be solved fairly quickly. See, a square, so a is this side, 2b is this side, this is the hypotenuse and this is 1.5x. This is 1.5x. Very similarly, B and 2a, the hypotenuse here, these, it's a median, so this will be 2x and 2x. Add it all up. What do you get? A square plus 2a whole square. So you get 5a square plus 4b square plus b square is 5b square. 1.5x whole square, 2.25x, and 2x whole square is 4x. So that is 6.25x square, which gives me the value of a square plus b square as 1.25x square. Now, if a square plus b square is 1.25x square, yes, Jaydev, a median is a point which connects the vertex to the midpoint of the other side. Median connects vertex to midpoint. Now, a square plus b square is 1.25x. Now, you suppose you consider this as 90 degree. So, that will mean 2a square plus 2b square is equal to the third side square. We are given that the third side is 12 root 5. So, let's use that. So, 2a square is 4a square plus 4b square is 144 into 5. 4a square plus 4b square. So, I add a square plus b square is 1.25x. So, 4a square plus 4b square will be 5x square. So, 5x square is 5 into 144, which means x square is 144, which means x is 12. Now, once I got x as 12, I am asked smaller of the first two sides. 3x is x into 12, 3 into 12, 36. 4x is 48. Smaller of the two sides is 36. A little bit of calculations are involved in this. Not something, honestly speaking, not something that I expect you to do in the exam. Not something that I expect you to do in the exam, but still, it's a good question. You should be okay with the concepts that are discussed here. Should I go to the next question? Jaydev, Nikunj, Vikas, are you okay with this? Vikas calculated 36 fairly quickly. Good job, Vikas. Good job. You calculated 36 fairly quickly. Now, this is a data sufficiency question. This is a data sufficiency question. Which of these statements is enough to tell you that ABC is an isosceles triangle or not? No, you cannot do that. Because you cannot assume that these triangles, this is a Pythagorean triangle. You are not given that, so you cannot assume that. Because this is not a right angle triangle. The medians are perpendicular to each other. The sides are not perpendicular to each other. So you cannot assume that. No, you won't. You made a calculation mistake. Because if you assume 5 as 12 root 5, if you assume 5 as 12 root 5, then it would have been 12 by root 5. So, your answer would have been 3 into 36 by root 5. You made a calculation mistake. So, in these, which statement is enough? Is the first one enough? Is the second one enough? Which one is enough to tell you if it is an isosceles triangle? Either one or two is what Dhruv says. Let's check. First one, angle BAC is 50. Angle ABC minus BCA. ABC minus BCA is 30. So, if BCA is X, this is X plus 30, which means the total is 2X. The total is X plus 50 plus x plus 30 is 180 or 2x is 100 or x comes out as 50. So I've got this angle as 50, I've got this angle as 80, two angles are equal. So yes, first statement is enough to answer the question and your answer will be yes. Let's look at the second statement. AD is equal to DC. So that means BD is the median. We are also given BD is perpendicular to AC. So this is 90 degree. So now if this is X, sorry, let me use something else. If this is A and this is B, then this is also B. So what will be BC? Root of A square plus B square. What will be AB? That will also be root of A square plus B square. So once again, with the red one also, we have said, found out that yes, it is an isosceles triangle. So either one or two is sufficient to answer the question. Both of them are good enough. No, Vikas, you are incorrect. Dhruv, you are correct. Both of them can be used individually to answer the question. Vikas, you are saying simultaneously, that is wrong. We can use either the first one or the second one. When you write simultaneously, it means that both of them need to be used together. That's not required here. That's not necessary here. Individually, they are good enough. Yes, Vikas. So I guess that is pretty much it for the doubt class. Once again, in case you are planning to register for any of the courses on Unacademy, please use the coupon code HANDA. If you want to send me your doubts so that they can be discussed in the next doubt class, my mail ID is ravihanda@gmail.com. And finally, the more important bit, tomorrow I am conducting a business awareness quiz at 7 p.m. on the Unacademy app. If you are planning for IIFT or that or any MBA entrance exam, please attend that particular quiz. And I hope you guys would have done that by now. If you have not, please like this video. Please subscribe to our channel. The more likes we get, the more free classes we will be encouraged to take. That's pretty much it for now. So I have another class at 12 o'clock after an hour break, where I'll talk about how to strategize for CAT 2021 preparation in the remaining 6 months. Answer to the previous question. Previous question was 36 and this one is either one or two. Both of them are individually sufficient. Thank you, Sajan. Thanks for coming to class. Hope to see you guys soon. Bye, everyone. Bye, guys.